Evidence-based practice, EBP, is becoming an integral part of the social service sector. Evidence-based thinking has become the major bedrock of many governments' approaches to policymaking and social intervention. Evidence as a systematic approach to policy and practice formation has influenced a wide range of disciplines, including medicine, public management, education, developmental studies, criminology, healthcare, and social work, with the intention of increasing transparency with rigorous, standardized, and up-to-date evaluations. When making decision about intervention for clients, you can refer to EBP process. The EBP process has 5 steps. First, ask client-oriented, relevant, and answerable questions. We can use PICO to form an EBP question. P is for population or clients. It refers to recipients or potential beneficiaries of a service or intervention. I is for intervention, which refers to service or planned action to be delivered to the population. C is for comparison. It refers to an alternative service or action that may or may not achieve similar outcomes. O is for outcome. It refers to the ways in which the service or action can be measured so as to establish whether it has had the desired effect. For example, you can ask a question like, for SYU students directly entering year 2, how does the provision of a face-to-face English course, compared with online teaching during the summer period, affect their grades in English writing, ENG 211 and 212? Next, you will have to search for the best evidence to answer the question. To do so, you must determine the level of evidence that best answers the question. Research evidence can be viewed from a hierarchical perspective. The best evidence that provides the most reliable information is at the top of the list, and the least reliable is at the bottom. The amount of research literature decreases as you move up the pyramid. However, the evidence at the top of the pyramid is increasingly relevant to answer practical questions about interventions. The level and quality of the evidence are important to practitioners because they give them the confidence they need to make decisions. So, where does the pool of evidence come from? There are 2 types of evidence sources: primary literature and secondary literature. Primary literature contains the original data and analysis from research studies without outside evaluation or interpretation, such as peer-reviewed research article and dissertations. Secondary literature provides analysis, synthesis, interpretation, and evaluation of the primary works. Examples of secondary evidence include systematic reviews, meta-analyses, practice guidelines, structured abstracts, and textbooks. These studies are compared using statistical analysis. When the studies are well designed and executed, they provide the strongest evidence and therefore the most confidence for decision making. So, after determining the level of evidence, let's begin the search for evidence to guide decisions at the highest possible level in the 5S pyramid of evidence. Systems refer to computerized decision support systems that search for the best evidence from applicable research based on a given client's information. For example, a computerized decision support system that integrates students' electronic performance records and their individual academic characteristics with the current evidence-based teaching guidelines. If you have such a computerized decision support system, you don't need to look any further. If you do not work in such an environment, or if you do, but the system does not provide support for your client's problems, then the next place to look is for integrated evidence in a summary, such as an evidence-based textbook or practice guidelines. Summaries compile the best evidence from several of the lower layers of the pyramid, especially from systematic reviews or syntheses, providing a wide range of intervention information rather than only one specific type of evidence. If the topic is not covered there, look for a synopsis in one of the evidence-based journals suited to your practice, such as the Journal of Evidence-Based Practices for Schools. Synopses provided abbreviated descriptions of a wide range of studies or systematic reviews. If you have no luck there, look for syntheses in journal libraries such as Campbell Collaboration. Syntheses are systematic reviews of the literature on a given topic. Failing that, you can even look up the original studies. Studies include randomized controlled trials RCTs, cohort studies, case-controlled studies, and case reports. Now we come to step 3 of the EBP process, which is to critically appraise the evidence. For those filtered evidence, we may not need to further appraise them as they are already reviewed. But for those unfiltered evidence, we need to efficiently conduct an appraisal of evidence by asking these 3 questions. First, are the results of the study valid? That is to say, are the results as close to the truth as possible? Did the researchers conduct the study using the best research methods possible? How true are the results? Second, what are the results? How reliable are the results? This includes whether the intervention worked consistently and how large an intervention effect it was. How well was it conducted? Third, will the results help me in caring for my clients? Or rather, is the evidence applicable to my case? How useful is it in practice? The answers to these questions ensure the relevance and transferability of the evidence to the specific population for whom the practitioners provide services. The purpose of critical appraisal isn't solely to find flaws in the study, but also to determine its worth to practice. After that, you will have to integrate the evidence with professional expertise and client references to make the best decision. Let's look at this EBP framework. Apart from the best available research evidence, clients' characteristics and preferences, together with practitioner training and expertise, should also influence the decision-making process so that decision-making is justified, shared, and tailored towards the clients. Sometimes the solution a client wants is at odds with the best practice supported by the research evidence. Therefore, you'll need to evaluate the outcomes of the practice decisions or changes based on the evidence. Measurement of outcomes is important in determining and documenting the impact of the EBP change on service quality and/or client outcomes. If a change in practice based on the evidence did not produce the same findings as demonstrated in rigorous research, practitioners should ask themselves a variety of questions. For example, was the intervention administered in exactly the same way that it was delivered in the study? Were the clients in the practical setting similar to those in the studies? The last step in EBP is disseminating the outcomes of the EBP change. In order to share the useful information with other practitioners, it is important for one to disseminate the outcomes of their practice changes based on evidence using means such as oral and poster presentations at conferences and in publications such as journals and newsletters. Whereas basic research is about developing new knowledge, EBP is not about developing new knowledge or validating existing knowledge. EBP, in fact, narrows the gap between research and practice and can be an area in which research makes itself directly useful to practice. In other words, it is about translating academic research results, that is the best evidence, and applying it to decision-making and professional practice. The point of evidence-based research is to gather evidence about what works in what circumstances, how to attain goals and produce desirable results, and how we know what works. Its purpose is to improve practice and address questions about what works. It is relevant for practitioners, policymakers, clients, and all relevant personnel. Most of the best evidence stems from basic research, but EBP goes beyond research and includes professional expertise as well as client preferences and values. To conclude, EBP is a process in which the practitioner combines well-researched interventions with professional practical experience and ethics. and uses client preferences and culture to guide and inform the delivery of interventions and services. It is a joint effort of stakeholders, including researchers, practitioners, and the community.